Hello once again, this is Squint and you're watching Let's Play Demon's Souls. I've done some work off-screen, off-camera, to get us ready for this next encounter. I went ahead and upgraded the large Sword of Moonlight 2+5 using our recently obtained colorless demon souls. Now it has an S rating in Faith, so, and Faith is our highest stat still, so that's pretty nice. We'll be using this in the fourth area of Boletarian Palace, which is coming up next.
Do you intend to challenge the king? You may be a great demon hunter, but I fear you may not be ready. The king is defended by the black swords of mighty knights and a fire-breathing dragon. They defeated even myself. That's how I ended up in the dungeon. Beware the limits of your own power.
Bior actually says that at any point after you get past the penetrator, but I decided to wait until now when it's more appropriate for him to say it. So I'm heading up these steps to go visit the monumental because we now have white personal tendency, which is that white light in the center on the little statue. So we got that from killing all those primeval demons and black phantoms, and so the monumental has an item for us now.
Take this. It will be of help to you on your quest.
The Friend's Ring.
Have you received assistance from the Candle Maiden? She is a prisoner of this nexus. It is her duty to lull the Old One back to slumber. That is why she helps those who hunt demons. And that is why she has become a demon herself. A soul is the essence with which living things comprehend the world around them. When one loses the soul, one loses the mind. And a land barren of souls is absorbed by fog and banished to the infinite darkness. The Old One is a bottomless pit of nothingness, with an insatiable appetite for the souls collected by its faithful demons. The Old One's very nature cannot be fathomed by the living. The soul arts shall be lost once the Old One is lulled back to slumber. A soul is the essence of thought, which is latent in all living things. You must never forget. The power that you now enjoy contradicts the essence of the soul, for it stems from demon magic. Have you visited the Pantheon at the uppermost floor? The Pantheon honors those like yourself who sought the demon souls. Perhaps one day your soul, too, will be honored in that same fashion. That is the most we can do to give you thanks. To give thanks to the brave and honorable warriors who must fight to reverse our sins.
Some more plot information there. It probably would have been better paced if I had visited more often, but I didn't really get up there too much. Okay, we're heading back to the fourth area without further ado. And right off the bat, there's a pretty interesting setup waiting for us. There's crossbowmen, three of them, two of which are perched upon the corpse of a dragon. I've always been curious as to why there's a dead dragon here. At the third area, you know, there are piles of human corpses laying everywhere. And my theory is that it's the remains of some kind of a riot or uprising or an attempt to keep the demons from taking power. But I was thinking, you know, there's the two dragons in this world, the blue dragon and the red dragon, and they're trying to kill us. But maybe, just like the human soldiers that we're fighting right now, maybe there are some dragons who fell prey to the demons and lost their souls, and as the monumental said, lost their minds. And there are others who retain their sanity, and just like the humans tried to resist the demon uprising. Maybe that was one of the dragons who, like the humans in the third area, were trying to storm the castle and got killed. But, you know, I might be completely wrong. Who knows? So up here we have three black phantoms, and they are all uniquely outfitted. I absolutely do not want to fight more than one at a time, because that is bad news. So I have to be super careful and use all of my MMO pulling skills to draw them off one by one and face them in single combat. First guy up is the one closest to us. Now the sound of the arrow hitting him is also drawing the attention of the other Black Phantom, so I have to be careful that I don't kill two at once. Now he would have probably gotten closer, except he got hung up on those barrels on the right and didn't know how to handle it, so he just went back to his original spot. Let's try again. There we go. This is a good one. Here, let me help you with that. So this guy is wearing, looks to be fluted armor, no helmet. He's using a penetrating sword. He's also got the fast roll and heavy armor, which makes me jealous. But he's not too bad. And like most Black Phantoms, he leaves behind an item. This is another penetrating sword. Well, okay, we've already got one, but I guess we can take a second. So now we have two to choose from. I recommend we go after the one in heavy armor first, because the other one has ranged attacks and is also very fast. And what would happen is, if we fought the other one, there. See, she's not really approaching us. She has ranged attacks, though. So she's got to be the last one. I'm trying. There we go. So what I have to do here is keep the his interest peaked in me, so I have to keep pumping arrows into him and get him closer and closer so he'll investigate. Because as you can see, they'll just move back to their position after a while. I'm not concerned about doing damage, so I may as well just put shots into a shield. That's right, keep on coming. Okay, I think we got him now. I think he is well and fully engaged. Now, I don't want the that woman with the bow to engage, so I'm going to back up here and fight him a little bit further away, just to be safe. This guy has Bjor's armor, the brushwood armor, a tower shield, and a scraping spear. Now, you've heard me talk about the scraping spear. It does, as you can see, it doesn't do too much damage, but its real use as a weapon is in destroying armor, and our armor is taking a beating. I know you can't, there's no way of really seeing that right now, but I'll show you a little bit later. Okay, for the last Black Phantom, we may as well just run in. There's no real reason to pull anymore. This one uses a bow and uses a curved sword. I believe that's a scimitar. It's kind of hard to see. It moves pretty fast. But you also notice her arrows move really fast, too. Like, extremely fast. You can't... You can't stand there and watch it come at you. And also you saw she took my health down really fast with her combo sword strikes. She caught us on our heels as we were coming out of a combo, and she unloaded on us with her sword. So... But we have her in the alleyway, which means she can't do her cute little rolls as effectively anymore. Plus we're using the large sword of moonlight, which means that anywhere she goes in here, we can pretty much hit her with regular swings. So with that, all three black phantoms are dead. However, before we move on, let's go ahead and scoop up all the items. I didn't have the luxury of getting while I was under the gun. Heavy armor black phantom gives us a tower shield. We already have a tower shield. Actually, we already have a white bow and a penetrating sword as well, so I guess that's what the pattern is. Have one more look at this dead dragon. It's pretty cool. Swords and stuff sticking out of it. Okay, before moving on, I'm going to head back to the Nexus and get some repairs for my armor from that scraping spear. Plus it gives you a chance to see why the scraping spear is such a dickish weapon.
Hi.
Okay, let's got some weapons to it. Okay, 557 souls per item to repair, and that's because just from those couple of hits with the scraping spear took off, I'm going to say, 33 points of armor durability.
Yep.
So yeah, that's pretty much what the scraping spear does. Mostly a PvP weapon. You haven't seen my stats in a while, so I'll go ahead and show you what I use this latest batch of souls on. As you can see, I've been focusing on my melee stats, keeping those up to snuff. This last part, hit points will probably serve me better than anything else, as it can be the difference between life and death. As you've seen, I've come pretty close. If I didn't have as many hit points as I did, I certainly would have died in several occasions. Let's just get right back to it. Now our crossbow guys are back, but the black phantoms, like others, are one-time black phantoms. They won't be appearing again. Can't headshot that guy. That's a shame. Oh well, I was being kind of sloppy anyway. Just ignoring this guy down on the ground. He's got me a couple times. Oh, this is exciting. You can watch me wail on a crystal gecko for a while. That's a cool little attack combo, by the way, doing a regular attack followed by a strong attack. Just kind of spin around and do a vertical. You know, killing geckos is good practice for stamina management. It really is. Okay, let's go finish up here. Alright, the alleyway to the left was a dead end, and this gate, this portcullis here, isn't coming up, so let's head right. Now there's a very cleverly hidden crystal gecko. You don't really notice it until it's already on the run. Unless you happen to know it's already there, and you can anticipate. Clatter of armor means a knight is headed our way. I want to finish up here before he stabs us through the doorway. So the large sword of moonlight was actually a pretty good choice for this final area, because we've got some knights with shields. There was also the black phantom with the tower shield. Hey, riposte. I promised myself I would get at least one last good riposte in before this let's play was over, and there it was. I think I'll have to be satisfied with that. Felt good though. Felt damn good. Should be our final assassin, our final medieval ninja. Just a couple of token offerings of resistance here by human soldiers. You can hear another knight breathing higher up. A two-handed sword knight. I decided to meet him with a two-handed sword of my own. Not too hard, just have to be aggressive. And plus he has a hard time hitting you when he's higher up on the steps because his attacks either thrust or they swing horizontally, so we really had the advantage there. Okay, for this next section, let me get some healing items ready, just in case. Here's the blue dragon. We finally have to deal with this guy. Well, like with the red dragon, not deal with so much as completely avoid. Because his fire does sting a bit, as you probably can guess. Right now I'm actually using the dragon to kill the fat minister that's in our way. It's important we take care of him as soon as possible, because gonna have to get across here somehow. Kept my pants on for decency's sake, make sure I have the fast roll. I have full stamina. Okay, it's time to go for it. Induce a flame attack and then run after it. There's gonna be a second fat minister, but the fact that he's alive means we're pretty much in the safe zone there. However, fighting him directly under the dragon is a bad idea. And here's something cool you can do with the crystal gecko. You can just send it back out there and watch it get roasted. Now that dragon's gonna stay there until we move up a bit, so first I'm going to get myself decent again. I am a modest fellow. And then we can run upstairs. And the dragon doesn't want you hacking away at its heels, so it changes positions. Whoa, frame rate, hello. Now that the dragon is further up, we can head back here and scoop up the items in safety. So let's see what the spoils are here. I guess he can't hear us over all that fire. And that marks our final minister of the game. Let's just work our way from start to finish. New moon grass, snazzy. And even more new moon grass. Okay, let's see what the gecko had on it. Chunks. And you're about to see in a second here why that dragon is breathing fire. It's because Bior's already up there. He's already up there kicking ass. We'll join him in a second, but first let's head down here and see what's on this corpse here. We have a knight's sword and a knight's shield. This is the part where I sneezed like three times. That's why I'm just kind of standing here. So, I'll show those weapons a little bit later when it's less chaotic. Right now, let's go say hi to the dragon. Yours running back and forth side to side, keeping the dragon guessing.
Flying, listen to me!
Okay, that last part got kind of cut off because I think I went too far forward, but Eor says, "May light shine upon our lord and our proud Boletaria." Very inspiring. And with this, we have reached the keep of Boletarian Palace. Looks to be Ostrava sitting on the steps there. Let's go say hi.
Oh, cheers. My father is up above. Well, what's that doing anyway? He's transformed into a fiendish demon. I began this quest in a search for truth. It seems I was a fool to even try. Please, kill my father. In his degenerated state, this key fits the Boletarian mausoleum. Inside the mausoleum are my father's two swords, Solbrand and Demonbrand. Use them to bring an end to this madness.
And so, unable to deal with the knowledge of what his father has become, Ostrava commits suicide. And after all we did for him, too. Well, at least he gave us the mausoleum key, which is used to unlock that locked door in the first area. Before we head back to the Nexus, we'll get this one last item. It's a Stone of Ephemeral Eyes, just in case we want to have some flesh and blood. Okay, I don't normally show you my inventory management, but I wanted to show you the Knight Sword and the Friend's Ring. So let's get started. The Friend's Ring, which increases your damage while you're a Blue Phantom. And by Blue Phantom, I mean you're actually in another world helping out somebody who has their body. That's how the ring got its name. So here we have the Knight Sword. It's a straight sword, has the attack pattern that you've come to be rather familiar with. I believe I've already shown off the Knight's Shield, but just in case I haven't, there it is. The base damage of the Knight Sword is actually pretty high. I think it's the highest of all the one-handed straight swords in the game base damage. However, it requires quite a bit of strength to use, and you don't really get one until way, way late when you already have all these awesome weapons you can otherwise use, so it's kind of a latecomer. But there you go. So we're ready to head back to Boletarian Palace. This time we'll be heading to the first area, so we can go make use of our mausoleum key. Okay, I went ahead and skipped us right to the door. Let me kill this guy first. Well, I say you can't grind your way to victory in this game, and that's certainly true, but right there you can see that we're definitely a lot stronger than we used to be. Okay, let's go ahead and see what's behind this door.
Thou who seeketh the king's sword, I am the old king. Show me thine strength and the strength of thine souls.
This is Old King Doran.
Prepare thyself, brave knight.
Old King Doran guards the legendary sword Demonbrand, or Demonbrant in the North American version. Right there, a true gentleman. He lets us have the first strike. He's actually going pretty easy on us. He's being very, he's not being very aggressive. Last times I fought him, he seemed to be a lot more aggressive than this. He's just kind of hanging back and going back and forth. But he hits extremely hard, and as you can see, he doesn't take a lot of damage. We're only meant to fight him for a little while and survive the encounter. And as you can see there, he also has the fast roll. Good for him. And that's what happens when you block him with a shield. He takes all of your stamina, and he takes some of your health anyway. So yeah, he hits pretty darn hard. So you don't want to get hit. Fortunately, he's just using a a bastard sword style weapon. It's actually a copy of, looks to be a copy of Demon Brand.
Thou dost well to impress one such as me, young knight. I am Old King Doran, and thou hast proven thine strength to me. Go forth and take the king's sword in thine hand.
And so King Doran is done with us. And he allows us to pull the sword from the stone. Demon Brand. This is one of a matching pair, the other one being Soul Brand. This is considered the good half of the sword. It's kind of like Soul Calibur and Soul Edge, I guess. That's one way of thinking about it. Let's have a look at its stats. So they're pretty impressive. The attack power of Demon Brand goes up with pure white character tendency, or goes up with white character tendency, I should say, more and more the closer you get to pure. Soul Brand goes up with black character tendency. You see here what this is trying to say: this blade power increases the user's soul far from that of a demon. And what that means is pretty much what I just said: white character tendency. You do good deeds, you know, kill bad guys, don't kill innocent people, and this sword will do more bonus damage for you. And here you see it has the attack pattern of other large size straight swords, like the Bastard Sword and the Large Sword of Moonlight. Now you can continue to attack Old King Doran, however if you do that, you'll have to fight him to the death. And that is not a trivial undertaking. He has a ton of hit points, he doesn't take much damage, and he deals out plenty. So for that, I'm going to have to prepare myself, get some different spells and stuff. But next time on Let's Play Demon Souls, the duel with Old King Doran.